That video you just saw was Cycles X combined with geometry nodes to instance individual grains of sand across a mesh. Every point that you can see that is sand is made up not of a texture, but of individual grains of sand. That means there is no point where it transitions to a texture. This is really a great example of how powerful Blender is becoming. Geometry nodes allowing huge amounts of polygons in a scene, and Cycles X just renders through them blazingly fast. On the wider shots, there are hundreds of millions of instances happening here. The longest frame to render was only 20 minutes long. 20 minutes per frame for hundreds and hundreds of millions of particles is a pretty good trade-off, I'd say. In the closer shots, we can cut down the render time significantly by using camera culling, but I'm not going to delve too deep into this because I've already created this node setup in another tutorial that you can watch here. Or if you want, you can download the node setup directly from my Patreon for free. There's no signing up necessary. The first thing I like to do is set up the surrounding scene. I have already developed the geometry node setup in a separate blend file, so that's going to be really easy to import. But I want this scene to already look good before I start the process of creating the sand. It gives me total freedom to move the camera around. I'm modeling the toys here using subdivision modeling in combination with HardOps and Box Cutter. These are really useful plugins. Normally, assets like these would be background items and low detail, but since we are getting real close to them, they need to have lots of geometry to still look good close up. When it comes to texturing these assets, I ended up using Substance Painter because it's much quicker and easier to get the results I wanted. I originally tried using procedural textures within Blender, which would theoretically give you infinite detail so you could zoom in as much as you want. But I knew at this point I would get better results and not be wasting any more time using Substance Painter. Texturing in Blender is useful on many assets, but I prefer to texture my hero assets in Substance Painter. I haven't tried Marmoset Toolbag or Quixel Mixer yet, but those are cheaper and free respectively, so I might give them a go in the future. I made the base for the sandbox by adding in a grid with lots of subdivisions and sculpting in the sand details. I looked at other sandbox reference images and they all seem to have scraping patterns, which makes sense because it's a sandbox and that's what people do in sandboxes. So I tried to replicate that look somewhat. I added a noise displacement modifier to add more variation. Okay, now I'm using mega scans. If you feel bad that you didn't create everything from scratch yourself, don't be. If this was client work, they really only care about the end result and how quickly you can get it to them. I'm using these wood planks to make the sides of the sandbox. Make sure to rotate and offset them slightly to add realism. The real world is not full of perfect angles. Since we won't see the ground, I am just using a plane with a solid green texture. This will color the light that bounces onto other parts of the scene. Now I loaded in a daytime shot from HDRI Haven. I don't care about seeing these buildings in the background because I'm going to add a fence around the scene. Now I'm grabbing a nice shed texture and using images as planes, I can model an entire shed from this one image. When it comes to photorealistic backgrounds, image textures will save you a ton of time. They're so powerful. You get so much free information in just a single image. To quickly create these pillars, add in loop cuts, and then after you've lined them up, you can select them and press Ctrl B to bevel them. Add loop cuts for each plank and then select all the faces. Press F3, type in extrude individual faces. If you switch over to individual origins here, you can rotate every face independently. Extrude out the side to add depth and UV project the same shed texture and repeat the process on the other side. For the fences, I'm using the exact same method, loop cuts and extruding. I place them around freehand because I don't want them to be perfectly aligned. I even changed the mesh in parts for variety. Next, I went on Flickr and I found a normal looking house. Add that image to your camera under background images and then adjust the resolution of the scene to match the image. From there, I aligned the image using the floor grid and adjusted the camera focal length to match as well. Using a cube that isn't default, I modeled the rough version of the house just to match the shapes. Then I unwrapped it by projecting from view. Using the tried and true extrude and cut method, I made the windows and gave them their own glass material. I even added a small cloth curtain behind the window, even though you might not see it. I knew I wanted a tree casting a shadow onto the scene. The sapling add-on will do for a background object. Once in place and textured, I assigned the leaves to their own vertex group and applied a deform modifier to them. I used this to animate blowing leaves. Okay, now it's time to make our sand grains. Place a quad sphere and add a displace modifier. Add a cloud texture and adjust. Make sure to set the coordinates to global, so all we need to do is move the sphere and adjust the size to get new variations. Now add a material to them. Sand grains are really, really tiny, so they're pretty much almost translucent. Add in some noise displacement and some speckles of different color for further detail. Then change the color of each grain. Now duplicate the collection and apply a decimate modifier to the grains in this collection. The grains in this collection have a really low level of detail, so they're going to be the ones that spawn in further away from the camera. Now, append the node tree I provided, or you created. It should bring in all the assets, like the camera and the mask with it. Assign the collections to our sand grain collections. If you turn off one of the groups, you can see where their different LODs come into effect. Here's a test render. I need to make the grains smaller and have them fill the entire view. As you can see, the grains are all at one level as well, so we need to give the illusion that it's sand all the way down. To do this, I added in an attribute random node set to position, and then I added a slight random variation to only the Z axis. Don't make this number too high because then your sand is gonna be floating off the ground. Okay, next, I set the instances to an insane amount, and then I adjusted the falloff I need for every single shot. So when rendering this, the close-up shots took a lot less time than the far-away shots, and this is because we can use the geometry node setup to adjust how many particles are actually being created. When we're close up, it doesn't need to be that much. You can cut it down quite a bit. Of course, on the wide shots, it's going to take a really long time to build all that geometry for each frame. It took around 20 minutes per frame to render, and only 2 of those minutes were actual render times. The rest of it was just the scene compiling all that geometry. As geometry nodes and Cycles X continue to improve, I think those two things are really turning Blender into a major, major player and quite the powerhouse. If you like this tutorial, please like and subscribe or consider supporting me on Patreon. If you do though, I suggest you pick the lowest tier because I don't have much on there yet, and I can't justify the higher prices for the upper tiers. With your support, I hope I can spend more time doing this, and I can bring you more great tutorials or just entertaining videos.